tonight on Network Earth. Discover why some of the simple things that you can do to save the Earth may not be so simple. Do compact fluorescents threaten your health? Is buying in bulk always the right thing to do? Are cloth diapers really better than disposables? Take our Network Earth not-so-simple quiz and find out. Then, Building Bombs, a documentary on nuclear weapons production, is up for an Oscar. We meet the two movie makers who produced the film, which they say reveals years of environmental disregard at the Savannah River nuclear plant.
Well, that's the real legacy of the nuclear arms race. We thought we were fighting the Russians, but we've ended up poisoning ourselves.
And in our newsreel, burning Kuwaiti oil fields turn day into night and may continue to do so for months. All this and more as you connect with Network Earth. Sometimes life is not as simple as it seems. That's what we've been discovering as we rethink some of the conventional wisdom of environmentalism. Hi, I'm George Lawes, and welcome to Network Earth. You've probably been hearing a lot these days about all the simple things that you can do to help save the Earth. Well, from our show and from books like these. And these things are good because they're easy ways for all of us to do what's right for the environment. But recently, we've been questioning whether some of these things are actually as simple as they seem. And it turns out that some of them aren't. They may carry hidden environmental costs, and sometimes they outright contradict each other. So what are the real answers, the true solutions? We're going to give you a chance to find out this week with our Network Earth Not-So-Simple quiz. It's better to use fluorescence than incandescence. True or false? Well, this seems like an easy enough question to start with. This incandescent bulb here produces 90% heat and only 10% light, while this fluorescent bulb produces mostly light and very little heat. It's very energy efficient. So that means that less electricity is needed. And the less electricity that power plants generate, the less carbon dioxide that they produce, which is the main gas that causes global warming. So, seems simple enough.
Well, have you considered electromagnetic fields? Fluorescent lights, along with all electric appliances and power lines, emit these fields, which research has linked to cancer, headaches, birth defects, and miscarriages. In addition, fluorescents contain a small drop of toxic mercury and an even tinier amount of a radioactive isotope. But experts at the Rocky Mountain Institute say there's not enough to hurt you. And as for electromagnetic fields, the fields from compact fluorescents are so weak, they won't affect you if you keep a reasonable distance away.
Aha! Just as you suspected, right? But maybe not quite as simple as you thought. All right, we're one for one. Bring on the next question. Bigger is always better. True or false? True, of course, buying in bulk means fewer packages. Everybody already knows our landfills are overflowing from overpackaging. Besides, it's less stuff to recycle and it's cheaper, right?
Jessica Tandy and Morgan Freeman in 1990 Best Film.
Phosphates. These chemical compounds soften water and help get clothes cleaner. But when wastewater containing phosphates gets into streams and lakes, they cause algae to grow out of control. The result? Other plants, animals, and eventually the lake or stream die.
Right, false. I said false, didn't I? So when you're shopping for laundry day, check out the big containers, but also take a look at the label. See what's inside. If you see phosphates, why not get a low phosphate or a no phosphate alternative, which could be liquids, because most liquids don't contain any phosphates. So, bigger is better in terms of packaging, but not always in terms of content. Gotta check out what's inside. Is it biodegradable? Is it reusable or recyclable? Is it good for you and the planet? All right, what's next?
cloth diapers are better than disposables. True or false?
Gee, I don't know. Let's ask the experts. Ma'am, what is your opinion on this?
Real.
I agree. Disposables are definitely worse because they put an incredible strain on the landfills. And, sir, what was that? We throw out 18 billion disposables every year. That's insane. Ma'am, would you care to comment upon that?
Yeah.
We do waste thousands and thousands of tons of paper and plastic every year on disposables.
But think about the energy and water used to wash cloth diapers.
Right. One study by the Franklin Associates consulting firm says cotton diapers use up four times the amount of water than a comparable number of disposables.
And you can wave bye-bye to all the energy used to run the washing machines, whether at home or at a diaper service.
But think about all the petroleum and chemicals used to make the plastic in disposables.
But how about all the pesticides and fertilizers used to grow the cotton for cloth diapers and the petroleum used for plastic pants?
But what about all the gas used in the trucks that deliver those millions of disposable diapers to stores? Wasted energy.
But how about all the gas used in diaper service delivery trucks? Shocking!
Sometimes...
I know what you're thinking. What kind of an answer is that? But hold on, everybody. Let's think this thing through. Thank you. Now, if you live in a community that's got a landfill shortage, maybe cloth diapers are best. But if you live in a community that's got a water shortage, well, then maybe disposables are best. Or maybe you should do what some people do, is use cloth at home and disposables on the road where it's really inconvenient. What do you guys think? Say, do you guys see the show much?
You should run your tap water before drinking it. True or false?
Now, I bet you think this is a pretty easy one. Why should you run the tap? It just wastes water, right? And after all, less than 1% of the world's water is fresh water, and a lot of that's already polluted. And population growth is causing unprecedented water demands, and in some cases, even rationing. And in places like California, drought is complicating the situation.
Think Major League Baseball. Think ESPN.
Some plumbing and faucets contain lead that can contaminate your water. One solution, short of replacing pipes and taps, is to let the water run before drinking it. That way, you're getting water that hasn't been sitting in your plumbing absorbing lead.
Yeah, I guess this one is a maybe. You might have to let your taps run if there is a problem with lead, but you should get your water tested to find out. Now, if you find out you do have a problem, but you don't want to replace your faucet or your plumbing, there are still ways to conserve water. Let your water run just once a day, and then fill some containers to use for drinking and cooking throughout the day. You can even use jugs to catch the water you're not going to drink and water your plants with it. Fill your steam iron, mop the floor. Fill your radiator. Clean the cupboards. Wash the windows.
Is it only up to us?
You know, sometimes we get bogged down in debating the right thing to do. For instance, paper or plastic. Well, they both have their good and bad points. Now, trying to decide which is better and making the simple choices in these books can help us to understand the issues. But we mustn't get distracted from what's really important, making everything as environmentally sound as possible.
Let's face it, paper and plastic, disposable and cloth diapers, incandescent and fluorescent bulbs will all be around for a long time. We should be working on ways to make their manufacture safer and more sustainable, using recycled instead of virgin materials, avoiding chlorine paper bleaching, using less petroleum and plastic, growing cotton with fewer chemicals, discovering ways to block electromagnetic fields.
Right, it's not only up to us. Yeah, we have the responsibility for changing our own habits, but the big responsibilities rest with government and business. So, how'd you do on our quiz? If you got all the answers right, you win. Our congratulations, because we don't have much of a budget for prize money. And just remember, those simple things that you can do to save the Earth may not be quite so simple.
active on these problems. Up next, Roger Bingham shows how to get environmental policymakers into the right frame of mind.
So how do you explain this picture? I don't believe this. All those Earthwise tips and you're still not worried about global warming, a hole in the ozone layer, or species extinction? We have to talk about this. You see, according to this article, scientists at the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, have come up with a list of what they consider to be the most important environmental problems. And their big-ticket items are things like global warming, hole in the ozone layer, deforestation, and species extinction. And the interesting thing is that that's almost totally different from your list according to public opinion polls. What you're worried about are things like hazardous wastes, oil spills, water pollution, and nuclear power plant accidents. Ozone makes it to number 6 on your list as well. But global warming, the greenhouse effect, is way down at number 19, and species extinction doesn't even make the top 30. So what does that mean? Does it mean that we're taking a very small perspective on these problems, and that only the EPA scientists have the big picture? So how do you explain this picture? The Earth Store, full of products and books and tapes, all dedicated to preserving the global environment. You wouldn't have a store like this if we didn't care about the big picture. Remember all those Earthwise tips about not using styrofoam cups or using non-toxic cleaners or unbleached coffee filters? You may have thought they were just little picture problems, but in fact, those local personal actions that you can take were part of the solution to big picture problems. It's not exactly surprising that public opinion polls show that we're worried about nuclear power plant accidents and oil spills and water pollution and hazardous wastes. Who wouldn't be? But that doesn't mean we've forgotten about global issues. When it comes to environmental problems, you know what they say. Not in my home. Not in my backyard. And how about adding a new line? Not on my planet. Here's an idea. How about letting the policymakers know that you do understand the big picture and you are concerned? I mean, I know writing a letter can be a bit of a bore, but a personal letter in your own words can have a big effect. Send it to the EPA administrator and copy it to the president and your representatives. And have a bit of fun doing it. Make it a celebration. Do it on your birthday. Say, I'm writing this on my birthday, and the planet and I would very much like to be around next year for another one.
Now you've got someone else to write, besides us. So here's the address at the EPA. William Riley, Environmental Protection Agency Administrator, 401 M Street, Southwest, Washington, D.C., 20460. Don't go away. Next, we meet two Georgia filmmakers. They've produced a remarkable documentary on the environmental hazards of the nuclear weapons industry.
Because it was secret, they were not answerable to anyone. Therefore, they just did what they wanted to, but it's turned out to be very bad for the environment and potentially for the health of a lot of people.
Everything that becomes contaminated with radiation, from gloves to bulldozers, is buried in shallow trenches.
Building bombs is not your normal box office fare, no Hollywood glamour here. It's about the 40-year history of the Savannah River site, America's big nuclear bomb-building plant near Aiken, South Carolina. But Building Bombs has been nominated this year for an Academy Award as Best Feature Documentary.
It's been a long struggle for the two people who made the movie. 7 years ago, Susan Robinson was a banker, Mark Morey, a labor organizer. Now these two movie makers are on the brink of fame, but not necessarily fortune.
What's the real danger of the nuclear age? Is it this? Or is it something also deadly but less dramatic like this, the toxic byproducts of making nuclear weapons? That's the question Mark Morey and Susan Robinson asked themselves 7 years ago, a question that began a difficult journey of discovery that led to their movie, Building Bombs.
The number one quality that it takes to do this is determination. Determination is really the main thing.
That's sort of the case with activism in general, isn't it? I mean, change is not an overnight process. It happens slowly like this film, but when it does happen, it's wonderful.
Mark and Susan made Building Bombs for less than $100,000. That's about the coffee and donut budget on a blockbuster from Hollywood. Raising the money was a difficult task at best.
And I'll never forget one evening we went to Athens to have a fundraiser at a lawyer's office.
Athens, Georgia.
Athens, Georgia. And we came back with $618.38. I cried all the way back to Atlanta. And Mark said, this could just be the beginning, and it was.
It was the first film for both Mark and Susan. They made the movie for different reasons. Susan as an act of protest. Mark wanted to penetrate the secrecy surrounding the plant.
The steam is sort of a symbol of the secrecy, the shroud that this place operated under for 35 years. And because it was secret, they were not answerable to anyone. Therefore, they just did what they wanted to, but it's turned out to be very bad for the environment and potentially for the health of a lot of people.
The issue is safety at the Savannah River Nuclear Bomb Factory. Making the movie, Mark and Susan discovered radioactive wastewater has been released for many years into streams near the plant.
What do you think the number one environmental risk is from this plant?
Well, there's several important risks. They have the 34 million gallons of high-level waste in these tanks, some of which have leaked. Then they have the huge burial ground where all the low-level waste, everything that comes into contact with radiation from gloves to bulldozers, is buried. Those are two of the big problems.
And it's contaminating the groundwater, and also there's a huge aquifer underneath this plant that could become contaminated.
The plant is owned by the Energy Department and now run by Westinghouse after 38 years as a DuPont operation. Its 40-year-old reactors have been closed since 1988 for repairs. The Energy Department wants to restart one reactor at Savannah River this summer.
Do you think that by making this movie, that by taking the individual action that you did in making this movie, that you've made a difference?
The Elliott line is, this is the way the world ends, not with a bang, but a whimper. And I say, no, let's stop the whimpering right now. Let's do something about it.
Was it worth it?
Well, I think so, especially since we've now gotten this nomination. I certainly think that makes it worth it, and it really brings the focus on the issue, which is the whole reason we made the film.
Encouraged by the success of Building Bombs, Mark and Susan are moving on to new projects. Mark's making a movie about Chernobyl. Susan is doing one about the health effects of radiation. As for the future, Susan says, a nomination doth a day make, but not a living.
George will be right back after these messages with the environmental news of the week.
Write us at Network Earth, 1 CNN Center, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303.
Time now to separate the truth from the trash with the Network Earth Newsreel. Is Alaska's Prince William Sound healthy again? Well, a report commissioned by Exxon says yes. The findings, compiled by three independent scientists, were released at this week's International Oil Spill Conference in Southern California, a conference sponsored in part by petroleum lobbyists. The study says in the 2 years since the Exxon Valdez disaster, plants and animals at the spill site have come back faster than expected. The report also says that wildlife would be harmed if Exxon resumed cleanup efforts. but Greenpeace researchers disagree that the sound is once again sound. They acknowledge some cleanup techniques do as much damage as the oil, like high-pressure hot water hoses. But they say the study ignores the impact of the spill on microscopic sea life, an essential part of the region's food chain. And they point out that other recent studies have found evidence of long-term damage to some seabirds, fish, and other marine life. And in Kuwait, smoke from hundreds of oil fires is turning day to night. This is Kuwait City at 3:30 in the afternoon. People in El Hamadi say they haven't seen the sun in 6 weeks. The town is in the middle of some of Kuwait's largest oil fields. Experts say the smoke is heavy with toxins like cyanide and sulfur and could be life-threatening.
It could significantly increase the death rate and put especially the young and the very old and those who are sick at risk.
I feel suffocated and it's hard to breathe.
Kuwaitis may find it hard to breathe for quite a while. The fires can't be fought until the oil fields are cleared of mines, which could take months. And when firefighting efforts do begin, it'll take months or even years to snuff out all the fires.
One more thing. In Toronto, Canada, they've got recycling vending machines where you put in a can and you may get back a jacuzzi. 13 Toronto stores have installed Lucky Can vending machines, which separate and crush steel and aluminum cans for recycling. Now, here's the payoff. You also get back prize tickets. So it's kind of like playing the slot machines, only you play it with cans instead of quarters.
You can log on to Network Earth's computer forum through CompuServe Information Service. Call 1-800-848-8199 and mention Network Earth to receive a free introductory account. The forum has information about the groups and activities mentioned on this show, and it also lets you talk with environmental experts, the Network Earth staff, and other viewers.
Before we go, one more item that should be added to our not-so-simple list. Last year, we did a story on a New Mexico architect who builds energy-efficient homes using old tires in aluminum cans. Well, recently, we got this letter from some students at Southern Oregon State College. Now, they point out that the best use of aluminum cans is recycling them into new ones because of the enormous amount of energy it takes to produce aluminum from scratch. Well, that makes sense. If you've got something you think we should add to our environmental not-so-simple list, drop us a line. That's it for this week. Next week on Network Earth.
We go undercover. Our target, the illegal skin trade on Fifth Avenue. Are we supporting the slaughter of endangered animals? That's next week on Network Earth.
I'm George Laws. Thanks for connecting with Network Earth.